Have you ever woken up from sleep and you realize that you have all this clarity and while you're so-called asleep? You're very, very clear what the answer is. And then when you wake up, it seems like it just sort of vanishes. It happens to me every morning now. Every morning. It's very frustrating. Again, early this morning as I'm dozing and sleeping, not sleeping real deep, I'm very clear about what the right perspective is. And then wake up and I can't remember what it is. Incredible. This has been going on for a long time. Probably the price I pay for being involved with the Romanticism movement in Europe, which was a German sort of philosophical movement in reaction to the Kantian viewpoint, which was really trying to correct the Lockean, Aristotelian empiricism of only senses. We only know through our senses. And there's this big, you know, this big philosophical battle in the world, and there was this called German Romanticism. There's in Europe, the Romanticism movement, and also the Transcendentalists in the United States, like Thoreau and Emerson, and that went into the New Thought movement, Emma Curtis Hopkins, and all that. It's just so I got caught up into romanticizing nature. And I was very much into that, as were a lot of us. And this may be what the problem is because if you bring the truth through into your waking, when you open your eyes, your senses are now functioning. You're aware of what your senses are bringing in nature to you, right? And if you've been lionizing or romanticizing nature, you're afraid that your clarity that you have while you're sleeping is going to interfere with your enjoyment of nature. So that's probably the problem. And the reason why now almost every night I'm like enlightened during sleep, and then I wake up and it disappears, is I'm less and less romanticizing nature. And so it's getting clearer and clearer. I'm getting less and less frightened of having the spell broken of nature. Now, we think, oh my gosh, if we don't have nature, what will we have? Well, you have super nature, for one. And beyond that, you have everything. You have the total glory of reality. So it's important to say, I want nothing that nature seems to offer me. Nothing that nature seems to offer me do I want at all. It has no value to me whatsoever. Nature has absolutely no value to me whatsoever. I don't want anything that it has to offer. So this is the way that we bring through the clarity that we have just beneath the surface. When our senses are shut down, we're not paying attention to what our senses are telling us, then we have this clarity. And for me, it's just right there, just barely beneath the surface. So we have to stop this romanticization of nature. And that's a tough one for those who have been so strongly believing in that, but such as myself. But it has to get done. I'm reminded once again, we want to be done by June 2016 with phase four. June 16th, by June 2016th, we should have gone into phase five, actually, which the spell of nature has been broken. The spell of nature has been broken. And I'd like to break it. I'd like to break the spell right now, so I can help others reach this also. In other words, graduate. It's graduation time. Now the bees are busy over here. Maybe you just hear them humming. There's a background hum. There's just thousands and thousands of bees busy, desperately trying to get some pollen out of them. And we think, oh, how wonderful. I went to the Monterey Bay Aquarium, and a lot of it's geared towards children, trying to convince them how wonderful and how amazing nature is. It's so wonderful, And just, wow. I didn't get caught up in it. And I went on 17 Mile Drive, Pacific Grove, 17 Mile Drive, all these beautiful places. I didn't get caught up in it at all. So that shows I've gone a long ways to demythologizing nature. and getting free of this spiritual romanticism, which has to do with how wonderful nature is. And when we really look at it truthfully, it's not wonderful at all. It's horrible, absolutely horrible. But we think that we're stuck here, so we try to put a silver lining on it, is what we try to do. We say, well, we're just, so we concoct all these, you know, romantic notions of nature that simply aren't true at all. Meanwhile, the whole thing is collapsing around us constantly, the hideousness of us, and we just have to somehow, you know, block it out with entertainment or something. And it's just very difficult to ignore how horrible it is. But fortunately, nature has absolutely nothing to do with us whatsoever. It's really our attempt to change what we are. And so be glad that it's futile and has failed, because we don't want to change what we are. See, our mistake is we assume that because we're so desperately trying to change what we are, that what we are must not be very good at all. Otherwise, why would we try to change it? And the answer is, what we are is perfect, but what we're trying to do is we want to be better than perfect. We want to be greater than God. Just simply, we had a whim. We had this whim of let's see if we can change what God created. Just as far as an authority issue, right? Not because what we are is bad, but because we wanted to see if we had the power to change what is. But now we're in the situation of assuming that no, we didn't do that. We're trying to improve what we are, because what we are isn't good enough for us. It's not true. So this is a very critical area to look at. The assumption that we must, in all this efforts to change what we are, must mean what we are is really terrible. Especially because how terrible nature is. We think, wow, we must be worse than this. Otherwise, you know, why would we be involved with this hideous nonsense? So we must think, well, we must be like really, really terrible. And the answer is no, that is not true at all. What we are is completely immaculately perfect. And yet we're an extension of God. God extended itself as us. But we're trying to think, maybe we have the power to change the very nature of reality. We're all powerful. Can we change what we are? We're investigating this. Can we change what we are? And the answer is no. But we've wrapped it up in this ideology of believing that we have to change what we are, because what we are isn't any good. Okay, so we're afraid to see that how unattractive nature really is, fundamentally unattractive it is, because then we'll say, oh, I don't want that at all. And then we think, oh my gosh, the means to change what we are, I no longer am interested in that. That means I'm going to be stuck with what I am. Well, what I am is God. I am is perfect. We don't want to change it. So all of this is fourth phase teaching. It requires a sort of intrepidness, a refusal to give in to a reaction. So this morning I was, you know, very upset that I can't bring this through. And I said, well, you know, no, I just have to be patient and just sit on it and we'll see what happens. So in other words, you remain meek and humble in the mood of repentance. This is the fourth phase discipline. I'm giving this out. It's very important information. You remain meek and humble and in the mood of repentance, saying, I have a very severe continuity problem, and I have to evaporate this problem. And you remain in full stop in indeterminacy. So you're not reacting. If you have emotional reaction, that's determinacy. You're determined to react. No, I don't have any determinacy. Now, you can still function in the world, just going about on autopilot, so to speak, doing your jobs. But you can still remain meek, humble, mood of repentance, non-reactive, full stop in the now, full stop in the wow, full stop in the burn, full stop in indeterminacy. This is the discipline that's required. It's required discipline. Phase 4. because we're looking at what is absolutely fundamental to our whole situation, which is our supposed relationship with nature. And we're considering having the spell be broken. But then we think, wow, how can I then change what I am? Well, I can't. And then we have to look at that conclusion. That means what? Is that good or bad? Well, it's good, because we don't need to change what we are. We're perfect, because we are the oneness. That is what we are. So it'll be a great day when the spell of nature is broken. For me, that is for sure. For everybody who's been through this. And of course, California is like the ultimate place for nature worshippers, which is why I came here. Having romanticized nature so much, I thought, you know, this is a great place to romanticize nature. It'll inspire me to create great music, and help inspire the world to romanticize nature. But on the same hand, I was also waking up. I was also waking up from this. So it's been a battle between these two dynamics of breaking the spell and trying to cast a more beautiful spell. And it's tough in California, because everybody's frantically into nature worshiping, romanticizing nature, getting out there, you know, smelling the roses. It's just celebrating what they call life, which really means nature, let's be honest. When people say life, they mean nature. Here, this is the world of nature. It's not life, it's nature. Life has nothing to do with nature, actually. Nature has nothing to do with life at all. This is just sentient existence of nature. What we are is spirit. I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me to be. Reality is completely formless. It's based on ideas. And then the intermediate step to that is supernature, which is devoid of what we call nature. And yet it still has an appearance. So living in here among the nature worshippers has been a terrible ordeal, because it really conflicts you. You know, you think, wow, I should be out really appreciating nature, because what better place to do so, you know, than California? It's got all the microclimates. It's got all the, you know, the great sights, and you know, just I could. Any moment I could just get in a car and just drive and be celebrating nature just all over the place here. I just don't do it anymore. I used to. Drive to the Redwoods, drive all sorts of hiking places, go to the beach, all the coastline, hundreds of miles of coastlines right here. The mountains, the valleys. So it's got it all. As many places do, but the weather here is also sensational, as is today. It feels like Hawaii here right now today. We got a little bit of showers going on, so you think, wow, I can just really go out there and just sink my teeth into nature. So if you can break the spell of nature here, you can do it anywhere, right? As they say in New York, if you make it here, you can make it anywhere. Well, if you can break the spell of nature living in California, you can break the spell anywhere. You've got all the deserts here, you know, just all the microclimates. That's why the movie industry moved out here. They could film year-round. They had all the microclimates, all the different scenery, you know, just it was an ideal place for that. Breaking the spell of nature, fourth phase, breaking the spell of nature, freeing oneself from the spell of nature, which is a spell we've cast upon ourselves. There is no quote-unquote nature, actually. There's nothing external. Well, is that projections seem external to us, but there's nothing separate from us that is influencing us. Nature is a projection, a mental projection. So it's not separate from us. It is an expression, our expression of continuity fear, really, at this point. Attempt to try to change what we are. And the desire to hold on to that attempt is what's called the continuity fear. So if it wasn't for the continuity fear, we would have dropped nature a long time ago. The spell would have been broken like that. Because of the continuity fear, we hold on to it. So we're in phase four. Phase four requires a lot of time, a lot of attention, a lot of composure, a lot of mood of repentance is required. But we can break the spell of nature. I'm convinced of it. Just a matter of being willing to do it, and try to bring that willingness through. And I still haven't been able to bring it through. Not many do, but it's certainly doable, and it's time to do it. So I certainly feel I will do it. We'll see how it goes. I'm not sure. Getting ready for supernature is also another issue. So it's a fine line between breaking the spell of nature and getting ready for supernature. And we'll see how that plays out. Certainly. We don't want to go continue on with the cycle that's taking place now in this world. And enough's enough. Enough's enough. Absolutely enough is enough. There's no point in even talking about it anymore. I mean, you know, if there are those who cannot read the writing on the wall, then they don't want to read it. They're playing dumb. And there's nothing you can do. If someone is insisting on playing dumb, what can you do about it? It's a willful dumbness. You can't educate them, you can't help them. They're just sort of mocking you by saying, "Oh, I don't get it, I don't get it, what are you talking about?" It's a willful playing dumb. And they're trying to make it seem as though there's some natural dynamic which is obscuring instead of their own willful ignoring. Willful, ignorance is willful, very willful. It's become a habit. And we would pretend that somehow it's not coming from us, but it is. So, as always, during contemplation, quiet sitting, there's little lulls that come. You make an effort, there's a little bit of a lull. Don't give up. Don't say, "Oh, that means I can quit now." No, it doesn't mean that at all. See, nature is calling. Say, "Hey, get out there. There's so much stuff to do, you know." And you feel, "Okay, I've done enough." But if we're trying to break the spell of nature, we certainly don't want to go running out and grabbing our camera and say, "Wow, look at all the pretty flowers here." I know know, there's been a lot of aesthetic movements throughout history where people believe that the nature, life is fundamentally good, nature is fundamentally good, fundamentally beautiful, all this stuff. And they base their ideology upon that. And, but really, it's fundamentally terrible. Fundamentally, it's death. It's death presenting itself. We're trying to convince ourselves through nature that what is true and beautiful can be changed, can disappear, can die. You see, so death presents itself in a beautiful way, but everything then, you know, dies. Nature is an entropic, death-based situation, actually. So again, there's nothing here that I want at all. Supernature, there's no death, death-free realm. It's freeing ourselves from this whole hideous attempt to change what we are, and yet without with acknowledging our continuity issue, so we don't dissipate all form, we still maintain the basic form of nature in terms of, you know, outline of form, so to speak. But there's no death taking place. There's no entropy. There's no decay. Nor is there anything added to it. There's no reproduction either, because death just keeps producing more and more and more and more and more form in order to collapse it. Again, nature is an attempt to change what we are, since what we are is one, all one. The attempt to change what we are really is an attempt of annihilation, of disappearance, gone. What we are is gone. It's no longer there. It's not modified, it's gone. And so death means that everything is gone. You know, it's form. Form dissolves, right? It's gone. This tree, you know, 100 years from now, will be, you know, a decaying, rotting stump with all sorts of insects and fungus and various things rotting it down. Everything that we see, everything I see right now in nature, in 100 years it'll all be gone, all dead, without question, everything. So nature is death, essentially. Nature is death, that's what it is. And the attempt to romanticize it is really our continuity fear wanting to hold on to this and say, wow, I'm too scared to recognize what I really am. So, don't think there's some beautiful form of death. There's not. Something glossy, something tinsely. Lipstick on a pig. The pig of death is put lipstick on it is really still the same. So, see, we believe that nature's reality, and then, of course, everything, all nature all dissolves away, and dies. It's gone. And we think that this is all determinate. The fact is that we are actually imagining all this decay, death. But there's real no, there isn't any determinancy whatsoever in nature. It's moment by moment, we have a collective desire to make it seem as though something real can die. So we sequence it all that way, the moments. But they're not determinate, they're not connected to one another, like in a chain. There's no chain. There's no chain of causation anywhere, actually. That's why we can have supernature. We can just simply see all the most beautiful forms of nature that we have imagined, and they don't have to die or decay at all. We just moment by moment, we choose the same appearance, that's all. So, there is no natural forces of nature we call death, and the forces of nature don't even exist. It's a dream. Absolutely, nature is a dream, 100%. It's our imagination. It's our creativity at play, trying to convince ourselves that there's some determinate force that is external to us, that is doesn't come from us. And we think this force is changing reality. not realizing we're just imagining all this. We are reality, and we're just imagining this. There is no force of nature. There's nothing outside of us that is involved. It's 100% our imagination, all of this. Collective, a great collective effort of spirit to put on this show, little show here, of the belief in determinancy. In other words, everything that is born has to die. It's determinancy. It's already determined, you see. This, the idea that everything is determined like this is not true. There's no determinancy. But this gives the effect that we believe that this is reality is being changed for sure. We believe that. Such is the power of our imagination, very convincing, our creativity. But it doesn't really convince us. It gives us a nice excuse to say we're convinced, but we're not really convinced. Deep down we realize, you know, it hasn't changed us at all. And we're kind of worried about that. So what do we do with nature then? What do we do with it? Well, supernature, intermediate step. We can still have the flowers. We still have the beauty of nature, what we think is beautiful. It's just that there's no determinacy to it. So it is fully, the appearance is untouched. It's the Immaculate Virgin, which means the Immaculate Virgin is a symbol for supernature. Untouched. Each moment is untouched. There's nothing determining what is appearing other than direct desire for it to appear. No intermediate step in terms of desire. No determinancy that's causing it to remain, causing it to change. It's untouched. So the intermediate step, born of a virgin, so to speak, Virgin Mary, for instance, Immaculate Virgin, supernature, our experience of being born again. Jesus says, in order to be saved, you must be born again. Born again, what's he meaning? Into supernature. Awareness of supernature. So that becomes our new, quote-unquote, mother. People look at this nature and believe it's our mothers. It's what forms us. It's our life, you think. Well, supernature is a different kind of mother, sort of different kind of mother nature, that's for sure. It's the wombless mother. You see, the whole thing about the Virgin Mary, the virgin birth and all this stuff is trying to symbolize supernature. It's the wombless mother, mother nature without any womb, no reproduction. It's the mother-free mother, okay, the mother-free mother. And because we're so attached to this mother nature belief of this nature, it's very difficult for us to shed that completely. So we could say that the mother, free mother of supernature, the womb free mother. So we go at a leisurely pace here because this should be shaking up fundamental beliefs here. Phase four is looking at fundamental beliefs and recognizing, oh, this has been mistaken. Fundamental. the very root mistakes and the very root corrections. Getting comfortable with them, that's all. Just hanging out. So hanging out means spending some time. Hanging out. If you just hang out with someone, like, come on, let's just hang out. I mean, let's just spend some time. Spend some time together. Whatever comes up is good. You just hang out with your friends. You know, you just feel comfortable. Like, you don't have a specific agenda. Whereas if they're hanging out with some strangers, usually we have like agendas. Okay, we go to, you know, some event where we do this and this and this and this, and everyone feels comfortable. But with friends, you're just hanging out loosely, you're hanging out just. No need to talk or not talk, it's just you feel more relaxed, comfortable. So that's all we're doing, hanging out in the fourth phase, understanding here. And all this talk is something I'm very, very familiar with it, so it's not a trouble at all. Although there is, you know, residual shakeup from it, sure. All this love we seem to have of Mother Nature is really continuity fear. For the most part, it's made up of continuity fear. We're so afraid of our true perfection that we love what distracts us from it. At least we say we love it, but we don't really love it at all. We hate it. But we're trying to say that this hate is love, and then this really confuses us. Because when we see what really are, we say, hey, I'm not loving that. We mean, I'm not hating it, actually. So we say, well, I must be hating it then. So let's look at this confusion. What we're doing here with nature is we're so desperate to be distracted from reality that we love to be distracted. We're desperate to be distracted. So even though we hate nature, hate this, we claim we love it. We say, no, I really love this. What we're really saying is, I feel like I really need this. I really need this, but we think we love it. So when we see what we really love, this whole dynamic isn't there. The hate isn't there. The fear isn't there. But if we're used to using these concepts and words, we'll say, well, wait a minute. Since we think that hate is love, and there's no hate there, we think, well, there's no, I don't love this. See, I don't love this. This can't be it. Even though we feel it is it. So we see how we get imprisoned by our defenses like this. And just notice it. Obviously, it's very important, but don't try to grasp a hold of it. Just hang out with it. So you can see how we have a reaction based on habit. We're reacting against what we truly love as if we must hate it, because we think that hate is love, so we must think that love is hate. See that? We've convinced ourselves, tried to convince ourselves that hate is love. In other words, we hate this nature, but we feel we can't do without it. So we think, well, we must, therefore it must be love. Otherwise, I wouldn't want it. But we want it because of our continuity fear. We feel it's protecting us from being overwhelmed by perfection. So we think that hate is love. And so then when we feel something we really love, we say, oh, this is perfect. This is what I really want. We say, wait a minute. This must be hate. Because I love what I hate, so I must hate what I love in order to keep this equation balanced, you see. And we say, well, we hate this, we must have to drop it then. But so this is why I say that the awareness of the continuity fear is the key to salvation. It is the key to salvation. It dissolves these seemingly paradoxes, these traps, very nasty traps. I know in the times that I've been aware of the vision of oneness and abiding in non-dual awareness, there's something that seems to be agitating, like saying, this can't be it, this can't be it. Well, what is it that but the residue of the habit of claiming that we love what we hate? Therefore, it must be that if we love what we hate, we must hate what we love. We can't love both. We can't love equally what we hate and what we love. See, that doesn't make any reasonable sense at all. Very interesting. And so there seems like there's some in equation, there's some problem with an equation, and you need to solve it. No, that is not true. We don't have to solve any such equations. This is what a lot of the ritual sacrifice throughout history has been attempted to resolve these equations. And then all the, you know, the philosophers of the Christian church trying to figure out what Christ's death on the cross really meant. Was it atonement? Was it a ransom payment? Was it a substitutionary thing, appeasement? They try to, okay, they're not aware of the continuity fear. If you're aware of the continuity fear, then the situation will resolve. Because you say, you didn't really love what you hate. You simply refuse to give it up out of desperate fear that you would love too much, to love reality too much. So you still have been hating nature all the while, but just telling yourself that you love it, but you never did, is a continuity fear issue. So this is how to get past the continuity fear practice, is how we get past all the history of confusion in all the religions of antiquity. Of certainly Christianity, as its struggle with trying to find what the formula is. I mean, there's all these philosophers are just trying to say that there's this, Jesus solved this formula for them somehow, and they're trying to, it's just a nightmare, isn't it? Because they're unaware of the severity of the continuity fear. I've never seen, going back through history, no one's ever talked about the continuity fear. It's devoid, it's not there, it's not present in any of antiquity, simply isn't there. And so leaving that out of the picture makes it virtually impossible. And you're going to have to do all sorts of gymnastics, foolish gymnastics, to try and balance equations, you know. There's no equations that need to be balanced. And so those who are unaware of the continuity fear, they feel very much stuck, and they feel the need of balancing equations. And so that's why they have these religions that purport to solve this for them. But they don't. They don't solve it. They do not solve it. And what is, like, for instance, Christianity, Roman Catholicism, is St. Thomas Aquinas basically is the one they said that he figured out the equation. No, he didn't. No, he didn't. He just threw a whole bunch of sophistry there. It never balanced out effectively. Not at all. The doctors of the church have never solved this equation at all. St. Augustine, St. Anselm, what is it? Anselm or something? Anselm, St. Anselm, Anselm. All the doctors, none of them have balanced out the equation. There's no equation to balance out. There's a false premise. They just simply did not acknowledge the continuity fear is the real issue. It's the only problem we have. Continuity. We don't have any other problem except the continuity problem. This is fourth phase gospel. So if you can accept this, all of this other stuff, you realize, wow, I don't even need to struggle with it. When I'm going back through history and looking at all the struggles, for instance, the Abrahamic religions, coming from Abraham, the sacrifice belief systems, many sacrificial belief systems, and then the, you know, all the explanations for it. Like, for instance, Judaism has a great many explanations and legalistic, very clever, but it's all struggling, and it you can tell it's never resolved. It's never resolved. That's obvious. And we don't have to struggle with that anymore. Don't have to struggle with it at all. Once you accept the continuity fear is the only problem that you have, then it frees you from all history, all religious sophistry, philosophy. The history of this planet is all sophistry, actually. Other than some of the more mystical, esoteric aspects of religion, like Judaism has a mystical level to it, actually, which actually, in reading this, it seems to understand. It seems to understand, as Buddhism certainly does, like Radical Dzogchen certainly does understand. Christianity has had some high mystical traditions that seems to understand, but the by and large, you know, it's all sophistry. And what sophistry does is it tells you, you just eventually have to throw your hands up and say, wait a minute, this doesn't quite, you know, they sweep it under the rug and they say, well, just have to have faith. Just have faith that this is sufficient for you. What they're really saying is we don't know. We don't know the answer. And you can never know. What they're really saying is you can never know the answer. So just have faith that that's okay. Really. I mean, what is St. Thomas Aquinas saying is except saying, if I can't get it, nobody can. So just have faith that that's okay. God doesn't require you to get it or something. But that's not true. It is absolutely not true. It's absolutely not true. There are those who have seen through all of this. And everyone has to. Everyone has to. We cannot. Fourth phase is beyond the sophistry, okay, of history. Absolutely beyond it. You see, there's an aspect of it within us that knows this for sure. It's just a matter of being dedicated to this aspect and keeping your faith in that I do know. Yes, we do know. We have a continuity fear. We absolutely can know. And because of this, there is no contradiction, paradox, trouble. No, there is not. Not any, there doesn't need to be any equation whatsoever. So these equationists, you know, are saying, I want freedom, I want happiness, I want happiness. Solve the equation for me. There is no equation to solve. There is no paradox, there's no contradiction to solve. There's just a continuity fear. So I say, I don't have a contradiction problem, I have a continuity problem. Continuity problem is the only problem that I have. The contradiction problem doesn't exist. Therefore, it has absolutely no value for me whatsoever, not even a shred of value. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. This is the root practice of phase four. And I say, just have faith. There is no entanglement. There is no entanglement. You don't need to struggle with all that sophistry. Going back and studying history recently, looking back, you know, I didn't get trapped into it. I didn't get trapped into it. I just say it's obvious. It's obvious what's going on. They're trying to have their cake and eat it too. They're trying to believe in nature and not believe in nature. They're trying to, you know, set up some equation that they don't have to deal with the continuity fear. They just say, just have faith in everything will be fine. You know, it's laziness, actually. This continuity fear is too severe for them. So they try to you know, have their cake and eat it too. But what's happened recently with Jesus coming back with direct teachings, those who decided to accept this has brought us past all of this historic sophistry of all the religious traditions in the world, and all the philosophical traditions, all the intellectual traditions, all the struggling and striving, all the nature worshiping traditions. It's brought us past all of the past completely. And we simply don't need those speculations anymore. It's not necessary. We simply felt that the continuity problem couldn't be resolved. It's too severe. So we took that as our basic premise, that it's unresolvable, so have faith that that's okay. Basically what everyone says, it's okay that we don't resolve the continuity problem. It's not resolvable, so God must be saying it's okay. You need to keep it. That's not what God's saying. It is resolvable. And in fact, we have to resolve it. Have to, but it's not resolved, it's evaporated. See, this is the trouble, when you're trying to appeal to lazy, those who have severe continuity fear, they want a pill, you know. You try to say to them, hey, look, you evaporated through a lifetime of effort. They'll say, oh, no, I just want to sacrifice, you know. Can't you sacrifice something and make the equation work that way for me? And so these religions built up around this severe continuity fear of people believing it cannot be resolved. Cannot. In fact, must not be. Really, if you want to look at it that way, they simply feel it's overwhelming. Well, so those who have a severe, really severe continuity fear will have these various religions build up around that. But those who have evaporated a lot of it don't need that anymore. Don't need it. It doesn't mean they don't need religion. Practice, absolutely we do. It's just that we have this new religion, which means new habits of attention, new habits of practice that are not bound by the old, you know, sophistry saying we can't solve it and that's okay. Have faith that that's okay. It's not okay. But we say there is no equation, so the issue of solving it or not solving it doesn't arise. It's not like we're saying, well, it doesn't need, this equation doesn't need to be solved. We're saying there is no equation. So that's very different than saying there's an equation, but we don't need to solve it. Very different. There is no conflict. There is no equation. There's nothing to balance. There's no moral outrage by God. God is not offended, quote unquote, by sin. There's nothing to balance. There's no payments to be made. There's no ransom. There's none of that exists. This is all simply our continuity fear talking. People saying, hey, I have that same continuity fear. I have the same fear too. I like what you're saying, you know. Good. And they agree. Okay, let's agree that this is how we want to look at the situation, which is based on believing they cannot resolve the continuity fear. It's too severe. And also believing that this is the only life there is. This lifetime is the only lifetime there is. We say, oh, how can I do that? It's impossible. Well, if you realize you're going to be born and born again until you finally evaporate the continuity fear, then you will not be paying attention to this teaching so much. You'll say, oh, no, I got to get it done. Maybe I can do it this. If I get started, the sooner I get started, the sooner I finish. So from my standpoint, there's no need for any of the teachings of this world at all. Both religious and secular, not really, except like the Jesus teaching, radical Dzogchen teaching, the high traditions, and the right practice. There is a body of practice in the world, but those practices can be easily developed without all of this history around it all. Absolutely. Because once you've evaporated a lot of the continuity fear, you simply don't need that stuff. It's not attractive any longer. It's not attractive. So really, this world has very little attractiveness left for me. Ultimately, again, we see there is no equation to balance. There is no equation to balance. And those who believe it simply say that they're incapable of evaporating the continuity fear. No, that's not. They never tried. They're so afraid they don't want to try. So again, they're locking themselves in and saying, it's impossible. I can't do it. What they're really saying is, I'm too scared to even try. But I'm saying, you must do it. You must evaporate the continuity fear. You have no choice. No one has the slightest choice in this whatsoever. What they're really afraid of is that they might succeed. And what I'm saying, don't worry about that. You will not succeed quickly at all. You will put the brakes on. So you must go through this process of evaporating gradually, patience. And it may very well take you a lifetime. So you better get started. But I see, you know, just telling people that you don't really have to work at it. And it's not possible. Just take it on faith. You don't need to, really. That's not right. It's not true teaching. That's misleading. That's pandering to people's continuity fear. And sure, you can build a huge institution on that. If you want to pander to people's continuity fear, you can be a great world hero. You can set up a huge religion or huge belief system, a huge whatever techno planet, and what you can be a big shot if you pander to people's continuity fear, for sure, because that's what everybody wants to hear. Very vulnerable to that. But if you tell them the truth, that don't pander to them. Say, no, you must do it. You have to get started. There's no way out of that ever. Yeah, not many people want to hear that. They say, no, can't you make an exception for me? Can't I get some sort of exemption here? Can I bribe you somehow? Can't I bribe you somehow in some way? Can't you talk to God and get exception? No, not at all. Nobody has some special influence with God. The idea of the nature worshipers that Virgin Mary has some special influence with Jesus, for instance, and can change Jesus' mind is ridiculous. That again comes from fear and delusion. And we don't want to succeed. We don't want to succeed. So what they're really saying, can't we get an exemption? Can't we get an exception? If we pray the Virgin Mary constantly, doesn't that earn us an exemption from this? No, it doesn't. Not in the slightest bit. So, the sooner you start, the sooner you finish. That should be the mantra. The sooner I start, the sooner I finish. The more I put into it, the more I get out of it. The more time I spend at it, the quicker, the closer the finish line is. So, you know, yes, all this past history has been much of it silly and futile, but we're not criticizing it in the way that the atheist tech people do. Say, well, it just proves there's no God. It's not true at all. It just proves there's a severe continuity fear. See, so we're not saying get rid of all religion. We're saying you must base religion on acceptance of the continuity fear, which means repentance. Which means repentance really means there's something I have to do. There's no way around it. You see, the unrepentant say, no, I don't have to solve the continuity fear. Not at all. I can just magically, up through faith, say, God's made an exemption for me. No, there is no exemption. So, repentance is to say, there is no exemption, there is no exception, I am not an exception, I don't have an exemption whatsoever. Nobody does. Therefore, I have no choice but to work on this. That's the mood of repentance, okay? I have no choice but to work on this, and reason will guide me. I have guidance. So who gets the job done? Only the repentant get the job done. Those are the only ones that get the job done. The rest are still going on the faith that through some magic, through worshiping, appreciating, sacrificing to some imaginary power, that this power can intervene on their behalf and get an exemption from God. So we can say, oh, I don't have to evaporate the continuity fear. I can remain worshiping death, continue to worship death, and I'll be happy with that. See, God will change my nature, so I'm happy with death, happy with this dream of death. This is folly. This is absolute folly. Misteaching, mistaken teaching. If you're going to use faith, have faith that there's absolutely no exceptions or exemptions whatsoever. The totality that is, there's not a slightest exception to it. God is completely zero-dimensional, zero-preferential, pure space just saturates all. This can never change. The nature of reality cannot be changed at all. So it is completely futile to put all your time and effort, any time or effort, into propitiating what you think is are deities that have some influence with God. There is no influence with God. There's no exception. There's no exemption. Nobody go to God and say, God, could you please make an exemption for my friend? No. Can you, you know, like a deity's being worshipped, the deity goes to God and says, God, can you please make an exception for my worshipers? Because if you don't, they'll stop worshipping me. And God will say, no. Okay. Of course, that's completely impossible. So you get this dynamic, you get this setup of this idea of some sort of deity, many worshipers, and this mutual dependence that the deity's saying, God, you gotta give some exemptions, otherwise they'll stop worshiping me, and then I will feel like I don't have an exception or exemption, you know, because the deity thinks, hey, God, look, I have all these people worshiping me. You can make an exception for me, right? I'm leading them to you. No, the deity's not leading them to God at all. The deity is promising exceptions and exemptions, which is completely false. Making promises, writing checks that cannot cash. And of course the people worshiping the deity, they're hoping that this deity will succeed where others have not. So you have a succession of deities, you know, the people just say, okay, this one will get an exemption for us. So all this time and effort are spent on getting exceptions and exemptions from God, which is completely futile. Instead, if they just repented and say, okay, there's a way, I have to do this, and I'll just go slowly, I'll go as quick as I can, but, you know, I just have to do it, then they would already have evaporated the continuity fear. You see, this is the tragedy of existence. All the effort we spend in defending, trying to get exceptions and exemptions, if we spent that effort on the path of evaporating the continuity fear, we'd already be finished with it. Already be finished with it. This is the tragedy. The insane tragedy of this situation here in this world. This is what I see. People put absolute enormous effort into defending, trying to get, having the faith that that they can get an exception or exemption. They spend their entire life obsessed with it. Whereas they could have spent their entire life evaporating the continuity fear, and they would be absolutely in paradise, in supernature, completely free of all this delusional belief that there's some equations that need to be balanced, free of conceptualism, equationism, absolutely free beyond words. They'd already be free. This is true for just about everyone here. So that's the ignoble tragedy of the world. And we keep complaining. Keep being like sheep over and over and over and over. I need an exception, I need an exemption. Who's going to give it to me? Who's going to give it to me? So we keep looking. Who's the hero or heroine? And of course, there are styles in this. And as I say, we're going to a new cycle now, which means simply that we all, continuity fear, is now choosing a new style of intercessor to God. They realize, hey, the past didn't work. We didn't get any exceptions or exemptions. So we need a new style now. We need to find who's the successful intercessor. And we're shifting over, you know, to different style of intercessor. That too will be completely futile. Utter waste of time. Those that you felt that you were worshiping and believing in, investing in, believing they could get an exception, exemption for you from God, you realize that they didn't do it. And so now you're choosing a different style of intercessor. And I often say it goes from the male to the female, so to speak. And then when that female doesn't work, it goes from the female to the male and just keeps going on. You go from a the kind of society we have had to now, a high-tech society. And maybe high technology will get an exception from God. So they sort of blend, the high-tech goddess culture. We're believing now that the goddess can get an exemption from God. Of course, people have always believed that. But it's going to be more intense now. We're going to accept it as if it were so. And we're kind of, what we're doing is, you know, build it and they will come. What we're saying, let's celebrate the goddess culture as if it's already secured the exemption from us, for us. Let's just take that as an article of faith. So the new cycle has these articles of faith that you're supposed to buy into. And the faith is that, oh yeah, the goddess has secured an exemption from God for all of us. Jesus couldn't do it, but the goddess did it. So we're all saved. So let's just start celebrating, and we know that everything's going to go great for us here in this world now. It's all solved. We don't need to resolve the continuity fear. We don't need to return to wake up from this dream. We can keep this dream forever, and it's going to be a happy dream. Everything's great. So we're acting on faith. What I see is this whole world now is acting on this extreme faith in the future, which is based on believing that exception has already been granted by God, because the goddess managed to get it, and the high-tech people combined with the goddess, the combination somehow has already worked. I can tell you for sure it hasn't worked at all. So you can see how out of sync I am with the future here in this world, is because this world is the future of this world is a world based on extreme faith in what can never happen, actually. Totally misplaced faith. New world religion. Just as many in the past believe that Jesus got an exemption from God, which is not true at all. It's not true at all. They had tremendous faith that, oh yeah, okay, if I just, you know, have faith that whatever Jesus did, somehow he got an exemption for us. This is what we all, the world has desired. Our continuity fear is so severe, we desire an exemption. And so we just assume that, oh, Jesus is here to help us. Okay, it means he got an exemption for us. So how did he get it? And then we're trying to figure out, you know, how he got it. See, we don't need to figure out how he got it because he didn't get it. See, all this mental struggle that we have in this world, we don't need it, because it's all designed on saying, okay, how, one, keeping the faith that it did happen, then how did it happen? How can we explain how it happened? It didn't happen, so we don't need to explain. We don't need to explain what didn't happen. This is kind of the key to our salvation. We don't need to explain what didn't happen. We don't need an exemption or exception, because we know right spiritual practice, right discipline, does evaporate the continuity fear. There's no question about it. I can testify to this. I mean, from where I've gone to where I am now is a massive evaporation of continuity fear. What used to just absolutely scare me to dread now has not the slightest ripple. But I'm still worried, because I'm getting deeper and deeper and deeper into the heart of it, into the root of this, you know, so, sure. But stuff that used to bother me doesn't bother me at all, you know. So, and I know that doing the spiritual path as a pilgrim, daily practice, continually moving my comfort zone is the way. Moving one's comfort zone is the way. Mood of repentance, saying I have to do this. There are no exemptions, is the mood of repentance. That's the humility, that's the meekness, saying I'm not an exception. I don't have an exemption. And I can tell you, it's difficult because everybody else in the world, I mean, I'm speaking in generalities so as to avoid being submerged in a swamp of particulars. Of course, there are a few here and there who are not included in this, but everybody in the world is basically acting as if they've got the exemption. They got it. They got the exemption. So they say, we don't have to struggle with evaporating the conflict here. We got an exemption from God. And so as you're, you know, humble and meek and saying, I have no choice but to do this, you're feeling like, wow, maybe this is all just a waste of time. Maybe I need to do what everyone else is doing, just accept that I got an exemption and everything will be fine then. And so that it is difficult. There's a struggle with this. and just feeling, you know, like you're just needlessly, you know, making all this effort. Not true. It's not true. It's just that the world has not repented. They simply haven't repented. Repent, 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 for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. You absolutely must repent. There's no exceptions, exemptions or exceptions at all. Pure, unequivocal, no exceptions, no exemptions. Okay, pure, unequivocal, no exceptions, no exemptions. This is the gospel. This is the gospel of repentance. Only the repentant will enter the kingdom of heaven, so to speak. Because they realize there is no exception or exemption. I have to evaporate this continuity fear. There's no way around it at all. And so they get down to work. As long as we're playing this game of exemptions, we'll never get down to the nitty-gritty and do the work necessary. Never. You know, there's all these attractive deities, so to speak, psychic deities, and all forms that hey, come play, you know. I got an exemption. Let's go celebrate nature together. Everything's fine. And you think, wow, yeah, that would be fun just to, you know, go out and celebrate and not have to keep this, you know, this difficult, you know, path of full stop and the burn, the consternation. And just feel like, ah, how much nicer is it to go out with the party people, the party girls, the party guys. You know, let's celebrate, you know, just, but you know, that's ruination because they're totally deluded. They're unrepentant. So what I say is this world is becoming extraordinarily unrepentant. And the whole civilization is being based on this extreme faith, which is false faith, which is that they're. Is an exception. In fact, a lot of the atheists, the techno people, who tend to be much more atheistic than most of the population, they say, hey, their faith goes so far to say, you know what, there isn't even any God at all. So we don't need any exception or exemption because there is no God. they take it even further. So let's celebrate. Yeah, there's no continuity fear. There's nothing to go back to. Whereas people are not quite that far out with their crazy faith. We'll say, I don't think that's true. I think there really is a God, but we need an exemption. And then the repentance says, yes, there is a God. Yes, there is a reality. This nature is not it. We have a severe continuity fear. We must evaporate it. There's no equation to solve. There's just an evaporation of moving our comfort zone. There's no equation to solve. There's no contradiction to get rid of. There's no equation to solve. The impossible never happened. We don't need to explain how we got an exemption, nor do we need to explain how we didn't get an exemption. There are no exemptions, so we don't need to explain how we didn't get one. How is it that God didn't make an exemption for us where he made exemption for others? There's no contradiction that we don't have to explain at all. There's no exemption for anyone. This is what the dualists don't understand. And this is what they come after you know, which keeps us from abiding in the vision of oneness, is their questions they keep hammering away, like, well, how did you manage to not get an exemption? There is no exemptions. There's no question of managing to not get it. They said, oh, you're so fortunate. You didn't get an exemption, so you're special or something. No, not the slightest bit special. There's no specialness whatsoever. They said, well, but you're so different from us. No, it's because you're going on false faith that it's possible to get an exemption. So if you think it's possible, you think, well, maybe some get it and some don't. You know, you're a fortunate one. You didn't get it then, so you had to work in there. So somehow, no fortune at all. Just a lot of work. So again, speaking of the dualistic belief system, it's just a disconnect. There's a disconnect, fundamental disconnect. Of course, in this fourth phase, we're helping here to realize this. Oh my God, there is this fundamental disconnect. You can't have your cake and eat it too. You cannot be dualist and non-dualist. You cannot be dualist and saying, well, you're fortunate, somehow you managed to not get an exemption. That's dualism, you see. And so we're starting to wake up from this dualistic spell that we've been under. We don't need to explain how we managed to not do the impossible. It's not a lack on our part to not explain that. There is no explanation. Why should we be blamed for not giving an explanation where there is no explanation? How did you manage to not get an exemption? There's no explanation for that because I didn't manage. There is no situation where you either can or cannot get an exemption, so there's nothing to manage. So I don't need an explanation how I managed there's no management of it. That's insanity. So the dualistic ways of questions are really insanity. What they're saying to you is insane. So you cannot answer those questions. They must repent. Instead of answering questions, having their questions answered, they must repent. There's another way of saying being born again. Be born into the mood of repentance, that they have no choice but to solve the karmic problem. Nobody has any choice but to do that. So repentant, those who repent are often quite glum and serious, you know, I remember how young I was, very serious and glum. Because I'd agreed that I'm going to repent and have to do this. So I'm faced with, what seems to be a very difficult problem, very difficult struggle. How do I move my comfort zone? Wow. So I was always very, very serious. And sort of subdued, not much fun. Not much fun. People didn't like to be friends with me because I wasn't much fun actually at all. I was very serious and just saying, wow. How are we going to get this done? This is quite an undertaking here. So people say, hey, you want to come here, come do this? I say, no, not really, no. Sorry, I can't make it. People basically saying, we don't need to solve the continuity problem. It doesn't, God gave us an exemption. Let's have fun. I say, they're being repentant. I said, no, that's not true. And if you try to go along, okay, go along with the fun, then tell people, hey, folks, listen, you need to really, realize that you need to repent. They don't want to hear that. They say, you're a party pooper. Who wants to listen to this stuff? So eventually, you just stay away from all of that. So there. So if there's no exceptions or exemptions, that means we have to somehow move our comfort zone all the way to realizing or experiencing our perfection. And we think, oh, that's just incredibly difficult. But remember, there's an intermediate step, supernature, which vastly reduces the difficulty of it. This is what Jesus tells us in the Course of Miracles, Journey Beyond Words. This intermediate step vastly reduces the difficulty, vastly reduces the fear. Don't have to leap directly. So recognizing this takes enormous pressure off us, and then we're actually able to start having success moving our comfort zone. As long as we don't realize there's this intermediate step, then we're really dooming ourselves to too much pressure, and then we feel that it's impossible. Then we feel, well, I have to do it, but it's impossible. Then you get depressed, despondent, you see. There is an intermediate situation. However you want to explain it or express it, there's an intermediate situation. Which really burns away all the residue. You know, it's kind of like we do all this work, but there's all this residue. The intermediate step then actually gets our attention off the residue. Okay. It's really just an attention thing, really. We're afraid to put our attention where it already is. We're afraid to recognize the non-dual nature of reality. No exceptions, no exemptions to this. And so we have our attention on the residue. So super nature, there's no residue. So it's like nature without any residue, you might say. Nature without nature. So our attention, we can put our attention on it, but what happens is gradually we got no more interest in any quote-unquote residue. As Longchenpa says, everything is self-released. It's the now. Without any residue whatsoever, not even a trace of residue is actually there at all. But we keep believing that there's some residue. This is the final obstacle we have. So supernature, the intermediate step, gets our attention even off of residue, you see. And that finishes it up for us, finally. And don't struggle with explanations. It will become clear to you. You'll just sort of organically understand the totality. Oh yeah, oh yeah. Just get used to it. Move your comfort zone. This is a comfort zone situation. Spiritual path is a comfort zone situation. It is not a solving equation situation at all. This is why the full sitting quietly, full stop, don't struggle with the struggle, is so important. There's no questions to answer. There's no equations to balance. There's no equations to solve at all. We don't have to answer how do we manage to not get an exemption. We don't have to answer that. There's no answer to it because it's a ridiculous, whimsical statement. And the residue of this is what the final step of even getting past any residue of whimsicality that we think, because even the residue isn't there actually. We're just kind of assuming that it is. It's pure, unequivocal, no exceptions, no exemptions. It's not that this has been established or needed to be established, and the establishment of it produced some sort of residue. See, that's what we're assuming. No, there's no residue at all because it was never established at all. Nothing ever happened. So there's no residue of nothing ever happening. See, from realization of nothing ever happened, there's no residue from that nothing ever happened. We assume that there is. So this is the kind of the final fog that needs to be dissipated. Fog of attention. We just assuming. Oh, how did you manage to not get an exemption? How did that come about? You know, in other words, where's the residue of that? I don't see the where's the residue? Can you point out the residue to me of this accomplishment? It's not an accomplishment. There is no residue. There's no residue of effort. There's no effort involved at all. But we just automatically say, well great, but what? Show me the evidence. Point out that there's no evidence. Where's the evidence of the establishment of reality? Isn't the reality is never established? It is. There's no evidence of that. There's no residue, evidentiary residue whatsoever. And so we feel like somehow we need to be able to prove it or point this out. No, that's ridiculous. So it's necessary to this abidance in supernature, we could call it that. Abidance in the vision of oneness. This gradually frees us from this delusional belief that we should be able to locate some residue somewhere and point it out. It's not even, it's beyond even residue free, because people still say, oh, it's residue free. Well, where's the evidence? Where's the residue of getting rid of the residue? You know, see, it keeps thinking that way. Well, there's no residue of getting free of the residue. Oh, okay. Well, where's the residue of no, of getting rid of no, of the residue of getting rid of the residue then? And so it keeps on infinite regression here, see? And you think, well, if you just regress infinitely enough, You get some sort of obligation. There must be some empirical evidence. No, there never is. There never is. So this infinite regression is all nothing at all. It doesn't develop some sort of legitimacy at all. So, you know, the dualists will shake these chains. You know, they've got all these chains. You're like, oh, and shake the chains. Look at this, you know. That you don't have an answer? Let's regress one more step. Let's regress one more step. There are no steps at all being taken. There's no regression at all being taken. So again, they'll say, oh, there's no residue? Well, how'd you get rid of the residue then? If there's no residue, there must be residue of your effort to get rid of it. Say, no, there's no residue for that either. Well, then there must be residue of the effort to get rid of the no residue of getting rid of the no residue. No, there's none there either. And they'll regress again, and they'll just keep stating the same thing over and over again, as if it's some sort of causal regression, that they're getting closer to the truth. They're not getting closer at all. So this is the delusion which sort of is preventing our attention from settling into non-dual. We're sort of looking off, thinking there's some regression taking place, that we need to follow the chain, and that maybe there will be some residue. No, there's nothing taking place there. How did you manage to accomplish impossible? No management. But how did you manage to have no management of it? No management of that. Well, how did you manage to have no management of it? You know, just like that. This is how insanity will just continue on like that. And they keep thinking, but your answers must be getting less adamant because we're regressing more here. We're getting closer to the residue. There's no residue at all. But they say, well, how did you manage to have no residue? There is no management. But how did you manage to have no management? There's none of that either. And they keep thinking that they're getting more logical and reasonable. So you should be altering your responses, you see. And then become very full of consternation and upset, as we feel full stop in the burn. The burn is just, we're not playing that game anymore. And you can feel this burn and consternation. You're burning up all this concatenation, this belief in mental chains of infinite regression, as if they are somehow inducing an exemption or exception to truth from you, and you're supposed to respond as if we're getting somewhere. We're not getting anywhere. And this brings up the consternation and the burn. That's why I say you have to repent first before you can take the spiritual path. Well, you realize you must then take the burden of this burn on yourself instead of projecting on someone else and saying it's their fault. They can't answer. They're refusing to give logical answers. You see, there's no logical answer to that whatsoever. It's complete illogic, which is, again, demand for an exception and exemption. So you will feel this trouble within you. Okay, so I just sort of explain what the trouble is here. It's like feeling you should be able to get somewhere with this. No, you can't get anywhere with it. Thank you. And so just running back and forth, running back and forth. Nothing is happening. And you can feel the burn within you with this. No question about it. Now, when this finally, you know, this gets less and less and less and less, what I would say is your attention isn't able just to settle in to the non-dual condition. And then you're able to help others even better, whereas you put them through the burn and say, it's okay, don't worry, you'll get here. This is what needs to be done. Those who are repentant realize they have no choice but to get it done. But sure, on this path, you're going to feel miserable, of course. You're going to feel this misery of not being able to answer. You think I'm supposed to be able to get an answer there? There isn't any. And you're thinking you want to help others, and they lead you down the primrose path of thinking you're getting closer to an answer for them, whereas you're just being pulled into dualism, delusion. You see, you think you can get an exception or exemption by helping others. And then you realize, I can't help others this way. So they're not going to worship me or say, hey, you helped me so much, get this exemption. And therefore, you're not going to get any merit to get an exemption either. This whole thing about Jesus providing merit is delusional, okay? There's no merit needed at all. We never sinned. We never did anything. And nothing happened. God's not mad. There's not some deficiency. We don't have to get some sort of merit with God at all. This is 100% based on our continuity, fear, desire to get an exception or an exemption. And there is none. And to be able to answer dualistic questions, we think that that's generating merit for us. It is not. And we don't need any merit. We don't need to be worshipped. We don't need to be a hero. No one does. No one needs to get any merit for anyone else. It's absolutely not. Of course, only the repentant will appreciate this. The non-dual, the dualists will not appreciate this. They say, you're nobody. You can't get merit for us. You're nothing. And people think that you're valuable. Oh, you must be a deceiver. You're not valuable for us. That's how they will feel. So only the repentant who realize they got to get the job done, I mean, they have to full stop in the burn and go through it. But knowing that this is liberating you from incredible suffering is worth it. It's the price you pay. I recall some ancient leader. I think it was in the wars with the Romans. Some sort of, was it a Parthian leader or a Armenian area? Eventually, gave up. Everyone betrayed him and went against him. And finally, he said, "Okay." Tried to commit suicide with poison. Didn't work because all his whole life he'd been taking small doses of all sorts of poisons to gain immunity, so none of the poisons would work on him. So, in a funny way, is this intentional suffering we bring upon ourselves by not answering, by not going, not trying to, not realizing that there is no answer to how do we manage to not get an exemption. So we're not some going to be any hero. We're not going to bring merit to anyone whatsoever. So we have to then, knowing we have to face this continuity issue, we must resolve it. We cannot play this game of merit at all. This is like suffering, little bits of suffering. We take it on ourselves intentionally. So the poison of duality eventually has no effect on us anymore. So I think a lot of the consternation, the fear is like, wow, I can't get merit for anyone. Not for myself, not for anyone else. Of course, trying to get merit for others is trying to get merit for ourselves. Say, look, I helped all these people, so I should get an exemption too, you see. It's like, no merit at all. I don't need any merit. This puts us, shakes us up, get very frightened, very frightened. So meditation is this merit, meditation of no merit. Consternation of that. Just sitting quietly, not moving, not scratching, not itching, not acting anything out. Just this whole maybe practice, of course, is no answers at all. You're not giving anyone any answers. Because their answers are, how do I get merit, really, right? How did you manage to not manage, 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 to not manage? It's the same question. How did you get merit? How did you get merit to how did you manage to not get any need exemption or exception? Still based on the belief of changing God's will. See? There's no change in God's will at all. So there's impossible to get any merit one way or the other. Nobody can be a hero for anyone else. Nobody can get merit for anyone else. Entire belief system of merit is false. Fundamentally, it's the belief that we can change God's will, which is totally impossible. Now, does that mean that all the Pure Land teachings or Bodhisattva teaching are false? No, it doesn't. It means our interpretation may have been mistaken. The great teachers, the great saviors, bodhisattvas, etc. They simply know there is no such thing as merit. And because of that, they're completely free and can be very helpful. But we wrongly think that they gain some great merit with God. There's no such thing as gaining great merit with God. We all have perfect there's no even issue of merit at all. That's dualistic. Nothing ever happened to God. There's only God. All is God. Bringing the idea of merit in is inherently dualistic. Then you start thinking of great merit and lesser merit. So there's no such thing as merit at all in reality. It's not like God saying, well, you merit this much of God. And you merit, no. Pure spaciousness is equally present, equally saturating all. No concentration, no congealment, no crystallization whatsoever. Absolutely no preference, absolutely no preference. So we all dwell in this absolutely no preference freedom. All does, all intrinsically so. The issue of merit is a total non-issue. Standpoint. You see, those who realize there's no such thing as merit at all, then they become pure pragmatists. So there can be like an Amida Buddha who has a Pure Land as a supernature, pragmatic, intermediate step. There can be a Jesus Christ who creates a manifest a dwelling place for us as a supernature, intermediate step. Absolutely. This is not merit, this is pragmatism of resolving the continuity problem. See, we don't have, I do not have a merit problem. I have a continuity problem. Merit problem does not exist, therefore has absolutely no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. No merit, no merit, no merit. I do not have a merit problem. I have a continuity problem. The merit problem doesn't exist, does not exist. No such thing as any merit problem. Therefore, it has no value for me. Only vision of oneness has value for me. There's no issue, merit issue whatsoever. There's no such thing as a merit. Reality is totally free of any consideration of merit, good or bad, more or less whatsoever. It doesn't exist. So, pragmatically, we're led to repentance, and then from repentance, pragmatically, we're led to realization there is an intermediate step, and to move our comfort zone towards that. It's not a step of merit, it's a pragmatic step, addressing our continuity fear. Jesus insists he's not greater than you or I or anyone. All are equal. There's no such thing as merit from God's standpoint. God views all as immaculately perfect, without any exception or exemption whatsoever. No issue of merit. Jesus says he walks beside us, not behind us, not in front of us. So this is fourth phase understanding. I have no problem with this. This is inherently true. And those who are dualistic, unrepentant, will continue to view Jesus and whatever else as merit, you know, and needing to earn merit, as some merit to give to us, protect us from a lack of merit and all this kind of stuff. Totally dualistic. Still unrepentant. Largely unrepentant. Once you repent, you don't automatically shed this, but you're willing to listen to non-dual teaching. You're willing to listen and you feel the burn, and you gradually work your way through phase 1, 2, 3, 4. You'll still have vestiges of nature worship, of trying to gain merit, of trying to, you know, all this. You'll have conflict and you say, wow, I gotta choose between these two and I'm not sure how to do it. The struggles will be there for sure, but if you repent and you realize you have to go through this struggle, you have to relinquish falsity. And it's upsetting. It's upsetting. So there's upset involved. So managing your success is all important. Managing the upset is all important. Commitment to sitting quietly like this is super helpful. Dampens down the reactions. Quiet sitting. Don't have to interact with anyone. Of upset. It's, you know, our responsibility. The ones who repent, it's their responsibility to realize there's no such thing as merit, no such thing as managing merit, no such things as managing no exemptions, no exceptions, no such thing as managing the residue. There is no residue. But getting our attention off of any consideration of any residue whatsoever, I believe that's the role of supernature. That finishes the path, really. Because we have these echoes, sort of. There's no infinite regression whatsoever, actually. None. There's no histories ever taken place. Only moment by moment by moment. There's never been any determinism. And there's no even residue of getting rid of it. A residue of keeping it from arising. There's none of that at all. And this is, I believe, the final step. Supernature smooths it out completely for us. Completely. So fourth phase, we're just getting ready for the fifth phase of supernature. That's why Jesus invited me to his dwelling place, saying, this is your next step. Get ready for this. Supernature. These are the pure lands that the Buddhism talks about, for example, of where bodhisattva, you become a bodhisattva, or one who's all smoothed out completely. Truly liberated. Then you're able to then, you know, help others, encourage them on this path. Christianity talks about the higher heavens, the third heaven, and there's a death-free realm, there's a pure land realm, there's a supernatural realm that you go to, and it smooths it out completely, so you're no longer, even echoes of delusion are not even there. See, fundamentally, fourth phase, you're no longer deluded, but there's these reverberation echoes seem to be echoing, there seem to be reverberations. And so those have to be, you have to smooth out and realize there's not even any reverberations. There's never even been any. Those are the reverberations of hallucination. So this fourth phase gets you ready for that. So it's worth it. In fact, it's no choice. Everyone has to. Again, no exceptions, no merit whatsoever. No merit to lose, no merit to earn. It's always been this way. See, the whole thing I have about residue is the belief in time, right? That this was established. No, nothing's been established. It's always been from the very, very endless, beginningless endlessness of it all. It simply is always this way. There's no residue, no establishment of it, no non-establishment of it. There's no establishment of a non-establishment of it. See, saying non-establishment, we still say, okay, how is the non-establishment of it established? It's not. So this great illusion of time still has these reverberations, as it were. So the final phase, supernature phase, vision of oneness phase, abiding in a non-dual phase, even those reverberations are now realized that too is a delusion. That's a moment-by-moment-by-moment imagination also. Even the echoes, even the echoes back in the distant time and in space, that too is all just a part of the hallucination, moment-by-moment hallucination. That smooths out too. I realize, oh, wow. But see, that's so so-called subtle, super subtle. And we realize even the super subtle isn't subtle at all. And then time, time space completely see through the illusion entirely. It's realized it's never happened. There was no non-establishment of time and space that ever happened, you see. Not only was there no establishment of it, there was no non-establishment of it either. Now, can supernature seemingly reach down in this, what quote-unquote, this reverberation we think is, and help, and seem to really help lift us up into supernature? Absolutely. I believe it should. This is not a contradiction at all. This is just a pragmatism at work. Moment by moment pragmatism, just as these echoes and reverberations are also moment by moment. If we can accept that, then supernature can begin to really help us here. Move us towards supernature. Absolutely. There's no acquired merit at all. Every moment is completely free and clear. It's impossible to acquire anything. It's also impossible to establish a non-acquirement of anything. See? That's right. Neither acquirement nor non-acquirement. So I can say this is causing much less consternation than before. Much less burn than before. Much less. So your efforts do work. Every moment you're spending in the full stop in the burn, you're saving yourself enormous suffering by each moment you do this. And the frustration is, you think, wow, how come I haven't succeeded? Because the continuity problem is very severe. So there are a lot of clouds to evaporate, as it were, a lot of fear to evaporate.